Thank you very much, Mark, and thanks for inviting me today. One of the things about going last in a What's New session is it's hard to be innovative, but I will do my best. I have quite a few slides. I will skip through some of them quite quickly. What I'm trying to illustrate is not the particular functionality of the system, but it's the fact that a scholarly submission and peer review system is being asked to do a lot more. It's part of a multitude of systems, and it's increasingly having to reach out and touch other systems. So there are simple things like e-commerce, but more complicated things like reaching out to citation databases. So it's a growing system. I also want to say that I'm not saying that a peer review system is the central system. Although I'm presenting it from that perspective, it's one of many systems. And I guess what I'm really trying to say is it needs to be a team player. So it sits amongst a whole ecosystem, and it's part of that, but it needs to talk to that. So I'm going to talk a little bit about functionality, but don't focus too much on the slides. Focus on the concept of it integrating different pieces of functionality in different systems. So one thing that came up this morning, and it's quite a useful metaphor, is the balance between benefits for publishers, but also overtaxing authors. We want to make it easy for authors, but we want to make it easy for publishers. And there's a balance that we really have to help you with there. It's nothing that we can dictate to people, but if it's successful, then it benefits everyone. So we have, when we develop our system, the Scholar One manuscript system, as I'm sure most of my colleagues down there do much the same, they have to focus on that balance. So we bring in features like, for instance, electronic forms. It's a way of bringing in copyright features and other things. It benefits a publisher, but we want to make it easy for the authors too. We can look at tools for managing supplemental materials, ways of sharing data between journals so you don't overtax your reviewers. ORCID's come up quite a lot. It's a nice hub that identifies a person, but it's a way of linking together lots of systems. And also reporting tools. There are fantastic reporting tools. They don't really get used to their full capacity many of the time, but it's a good way, again, of pulling data from the system and sending it somewhere else. So just to focus a little bit on electronic forms, they can sit in a workflow. They become part of that workflow. Take, for instance, a licensing form. You can trigger it at any point. You can have reminders that go out to authors. You can chase them. But it means that you automate the gathering of that external information. You pull in the completed forms and the reviewers. There's no opportunity for them to forget to do things. You can't publish a paper if it doesn't have a form. There's no risk of losing something. But also it's easy for the authors. They see the form in their system, and it'll look something like this. So this is what it looks like from the administrative point of view. Everything is seen on a dashboard. It's very clear. There's no way of missing things. You can see things if they're overdue or if they're outstanding. It's easy to bounce things backwards and forwards. But also from the author's perspective, it's also easy. They log into the same site as where they submit their manuscript, where they submit their revisions. It's a URL they know. It can be linked into the publisher's pages, and they can complete the form online. But obviously, if the lawyers agree, more often than not these days, they do. We do provide an option to download it, but then there's additional work involved. If it's on screen, it's a bit like a software license. You click a box, you type in a few fields. It can make things very easy. It's a boon to both people if people do this. Similarly for supplemental materials, we have tools for gathering those, ways of mapping file designations to the individual pieces of content. So people can identify data sets, identify supplemental materials. We can decide in the application what happens to them. Do they go into the reviewer proof? Do they get sent on to the production process? But all that information is being captured at the very beginning. It's easy for the authors. They don't have to do anything different. It just becomes part of their submission. It's easy for the publishers because it's all there in the system. And all this is rolling into the XML. It's all becoming part of that snowballing data package, which can then be pushed out of our system and sent somewhere else. I'll talk a little bit about ORCID as well. I won't go into any detail. Everybody who's sitting here today knows pretty much about ORCID and all the issues around disambiguation of authors. But it's a good example of a system that in some ways is analogous to an online submission and peer review system. It sits as part of a bigger ecosystem. It's one part, one hub, of information, and data can pass through that hub. We've already started it in Scholar Manuscripts to integrate ORCID. You can already put it in as part of your account details, and I'll show you that in the next slide. So we're already becoming part of that, but we're looking to integrate more in future, and that's really to follow that pathway of integration. So we're very keen to validate that ORCIDs are correct, and then start reaching out to the registry itself, pulling back information, and you've heard some talk about that already. But the key again is that we start to integrate with these systems. And this is the current setting. We were a launch partner, and you can store the information on ORCID as part of your account. But it doesn't do a lot more than link at the moment. And obviously, you want to make sure that ORCIDs are valid, they're in the correct INSEE style format, and that it actually adds some value. So maybe we could pull back account details, or we could push people out to ORCID. We haven't formally defined our strategy for 2013, but that strategy will include integrating more tightly with ORCID and a number of other systems. And that's just simply my profile, so it links through. Reporting, I'll just touch on here, but we have a reporting system in Scholar One Manuscripts. It does exactly what you think a reporting system does. But it enables you to do lots of things with data. You can pull out data, you can restructure data, you can output it from the system. You can also automate the output of that data. You can create reports, schedule them, send them to a distribution list, or output them to other systems. You can populate CRM systems. So it's a good tool of pulling information. You're gathering information, so make use of it. And this leads me into talking about the tools for practical journal management. So although they don't directly benefit the authors and reviewers, they do benefit publishers, and those benefits really do flow back to them. So I talk a little bit about how to deal with too many submissions, and I think a lot of you have keyed on to the fact that, well, you can start new journals, you can feed open access. So we need to look at tools to support that. Again, more integration that supports both those growing populations of journals, but also things like open access. So e-commerce, submissions from preprint archives, ways to automate to repositories like PubMed Central, something like that. Collecting all the data that you need in one place so it's not spread throughout the process. You gather as much information as you can at the point where you have contact with the user. And also, this comes back to my first point, manuscript transfer tools. So this is a very simple schematic. I've taken out a lot of the extraneous detail. But you'll see in the center there that we have the core peer review and submission system. But we start to link out to different places. Integral to our system, you can gather lots of submission metadata, which all becomes part of that XML package and you can pull out of the system. We can do e-commerce at various times, either at the very beginning to raise a submission fee, or we can do it at the very end, so it all becomes part of their submission process. Rather than having to chase them, you simply don't process their article until they pay up, or provide a valid excuse for not paying up. We can gather custom metadata at any point in the process, and we can do those manuscript transfers. So if you decide a manuscript isn't suitable, you can go ahead and transfer it to a different publication. So manuscript transfer, quite straightforward. We configure sites to point to a number of predefined targets. Those are other journals using Scholar One manuscripts. At any point in the process, if a manuscript is considered out of scope but worthy somehow for publication elsewhere, we can fire the entire package of data to that second journal. And you can cascade that. You can pass it through several journals if you wish to. You can get the author's permission to go ahead and do that. But that whole package goes through. And it includes all the metadata that you gathered to date, any reviews, recommendations, notes, and the manuscript files themselves. So nothing is lost in that process. And again, it makes life somewhat easier. Another thing is the back end. So you have an efficient editorial process, but you also need to think about the production process, how to feed into that process. Now, we don't prescribe a particular production process. You may have your own, but we want to make sure that you have access to the data from our system. So we can make sure the right files go over. We can provide tools for gathering the right files if you haven't already. So when an author submitted their manuscript, we can give them the tools to pull in final files, production-ready files, or we can give them access to immediate proofs if we wish. We can also give you a lot of information in the XML to take away from our system. So final files, as I mentioned, is just a way for the authors to use the system after a decision's been made, and it's used in two modes. One is for production-ready files, so maybe high-quality graphics, anything like that. The other one is to send them out a proof which they can look at immediately post-acceptance. And they have the tools to see those files. They have the tools to make them respond to comments. All those comments that they respond to, again, feed into that metadata. So this is the metadata. This is just a snippet of the XML that we send out. This is our default DTD, but we can map to NLM, we can map to JATS, we can really map to any kind of other DTD, as long as we gather the information. So every question that gets asked in the workflow, every question that gets asked during submission, it goes into this XML. It's available for you to use later. Nothing is lost. And we go into quite a lot of detail. We pull information on every task in that workflow. This is a more recent addition. So that form completion task, we get information on that. We when it was completed, what information was provided. All the reviews as well, information on what the reviewers said, their comments, their recommendations, any questions they answered on that reviewer report form, it all becomes part of the XML. So you can go ahead and you can publish full data on that manuscript. You can publish when it was accepted, when it was rejected, sorry, when it was revised, when it was resubmitted. You can also participate, if you do participate in open review, you can choose to publish author names if they say, yes, we're willing to do that. How long it spent with reviewers, what the reviewers said. It gives you a whole variety of things you can do for no extra effort on the reviewer's part and no extra effort on your own part, or very little. So just to cast an eye to the future, and again, these are things we're working on for 2013, 2014. One of the big things, and it's come up a lot today, is APIs. We want to have an API. We want to communicate with other systems. We want to give you guys the tools to communicate with other systems. We want to make it easy. At the moment, we support some APIs. They're mostly SOAP-based. We have to do a lot of development to do so. We want to get out developing bespoke APIs. We want to give you guys the power to do it yourself. So we want to make sure it's all quite open. We'll publish documentation. You can access that. And that gives us tools internally as well. We have some fantastic tools at Thomson Reuters, such as the Web of Knowledge, that we need to talk to. So those APIs benefit us too. And they also benefit initiatives like ORCID. So we can communicate with any other system. So again, what I want to talk about is communication. And this is my final slide. It's not comprehensive, but it's just an idea of where Scholar One sits in a whole ecosystem of services. There's things I've missed off there, but there's additional things that I'm sure you can think of, like content management. And I also want to say what I said at the beginning, that Scholar One manuscripts, although it's the center of that, it all depends on where you sit in this ecosystem as to where the center lies. But the key is we can communicate with internal systems and we can communicate with external systems. And I think going forwards that any good peer review and submission system has to be part of that ecosystem. It has to be a good player and it has to be a team player. And that's all I had to say today. So thanks for your attention.